Thank you, Travis. So our speaker this morning is Anurag Sharma, and he's a principal at Withum Cybersecurity Practice, and he came all the way from Princeton, New Jersey to be with us this morning, so we thank him very much, and so take it away.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So for the next hour or so, what I would like to share with you is some of the experiences that I've had being in the field for the last 15 years. What we see, what some of our clients see, and more importantly, what are some of the lessons that we can learn from others' mistakes, things that they have gone through, so that we can avoid a situation like that. And what I would like to start with is kick off with a small video clip. Because more often than not, what we see is that when we hear about the news that somebody got hacked, somebody had a ransomware attack, it all feels good, but we always have that feeling at the back of our mind that it is something that might not happen to me or cannot happen to me. And I would want us to start with this video clip just to enlighten on things that can happen and how easily they can happen, and then we'll get into the presentation.
Anyone with a phone and an internet connection can do social engineering. But I was curious, what can a hacker with serious coding skills do?
Well, DEF CON is the world's biggest hacking convention. It's hacking everything, hacking social, hacking hardware, hacking software, hacking various systems.
I asked Dan Tentler, a well-known security researcher, to turn all of his firepower on me.
I did get into quite a number of things that I found.
So what were the first things you did? How did you start hacking me?
I quickly found your Squarespace blog and had an idea. Basically what I did was created a bogus Squarespace site and sent an email to you, a phish asking you to go to this website, run this certificate installer.
And I did it, because I'm an idiot.
So once you ran that, it gave me access to your computer, and I created several fake pop-ups that looked like system pop-ups that would ask you for your credentials.
You didn't even have to have my passwords.
No, you gave them to me.
I gave them to you.
Yeah. So I stole your 1Password keychain.
That's and 1Password is where I store all my other passwords. So effectively by...
And your social security number and your AMEX stuff and all your stock trading and bank information. I can send email to everyone in this room as you. I am you right now, if I wanted to be. If my evilness is working correctly, it should actually be taking pictures of your desktop and pictures through your webcam every 2 minutes. And I have been watching you for about 2 days now. In coffee shops, at your mom's house, on a plane. Here's your editing stuff. There's you like.
Oh my God, so
nervous.
This is literally.
Every 2 minutes.
Through my webcam.
Yeah, through this guy.
How badly could you have messed up my life?
I could have made you homeless. I could have made you homeless and penniless.
How? How would you make me homeless?
Like, I have control of your digital life in its entirety. I have all your credentials. I have all your access to all your financial information, all your work information, all your personal information. I can pay people with your bank account or your Amex account. I am you. I can fully impersonate. Like, the only thing I couldn't doctor would be like your fingerprints.
This is like as bad as it gets.
It's ridiculous. Yeah, it's bad.
So it turns out that Dan Tentler is very good at his job. I mean, he hacked the hell out of me. He got everything. Well, I mean, frankly, I want to take my computer and throw it into the deepest part of the ocean, and I want to become a hermit, and I want to never touch a piece of technology again, because holy shit, that was everything. That was the keys to my entire life. And he just pulled them out of his pocket.
That is the reality of the world we live in today, right? All it takes is a click, an email from somebody, and if you click it, it installs a piece of software, and somebody can pretty much take over your identity. Anything that is considered to be critical in a digital form, he can take over that and cause you a lot of financial harm. So for the next 50 minutes, we'll talk about things, small things that you can do to try and avoid ending up in a situation like that. So let's look at some numbers, some statistics first, right? 14 billion. So since 2013, they started keeping track of how many data records have been breached globally. And the number that we are at is 14,717,000,000. So if you look at the rate, we're talking of about, on an average, 6 million data records that are stolen somewhere in the world every day, which means about 250,000 records every hour. By the time this presentation will be over, somewhere somebody would have stolen about 250,000 records. And the most important part of this statistics is only 4% of these breaches are what are known as secure breaches. So what does a secure breach mean? It means that when the hacker got access to your data, or he stole the data, it was in a format where he cannot make sense out of it. It is encrypted. So though he has physical possession of your data, he cannot use it. What that means is 96% of the data records that were stolen were not secured, which means basically they can be misused. If you look at 2018, just the first 6 months of 2018, that number was 3.3 billion. Remember, we were talking about 6 million a day? In 2018, we were looking at about 18 million data records every day globally that were being stolen. So that is the reality of the world we live in, right? Because data is the new oil. If somebody gets access to your data or your organization's data, your client's data, he can monetize it. He can sell it in the dark web and make money out of it. And that is why it has value. And that is why they would put in effort to try and steal it. Let's look at the various types of incidents that result in some of these data thefts or breaches, right? So 65% of the data theft was identity theft, right? People were trying to get hold of your name, social security number, date of birth, anything that can be used to maybe open a bank account in your name, get a line of credit in your name, or apply for a credit card in your name. And then the remaining 35% was a mix of account access information, login credentials, things like that. If you look at the incidents by sources, who was the one who was trying to steal the data, right? We were still looking at majority of incidents, about 56%, where the source was a malicious outsider, right? Somebody sitting outside your organization, maybe outside the country, because when it comes to internet and your electronic data, geographies, it's not bound by geographies. So somebody might be sitting in the other side of the world and trying to access your data. The most important figure in this is that 34% of data loss was accidental in nature. So let me give you an example what it means when we say accidental losses, because they are the ones that can be very easily prevented, right? Let's assume you have data, personal records of all your employees or all your customers or all the people that you are serving in an Excel file, which was in a USB drive, and you lost the USB drive. That is an accidental loss. If the drive is not encrypted, that data can be accessed and can be misused. I'll give you a very interesting example, and this happened about 4 years back. So Boeing, one of the biggest companies in US, somebody in the HR department in Boeing was working on a spreadsheet, and she needed help with formatting. So she was like, who best to go and ask for help than her husband, who is not an employee of Boeing? So she emailed the spreadsheet to her husband, asking him to format a few columns that she needed help with, without realizing that spreadsheet contained information about all Boeing employees, but more importantly, there were hidden columns that contained the social security number, date of birth, and all sorts of sensitive information in that spreadsheet. So when she sent it out, she was looking at what was visible, which was maybe, you know, name and some other details, but there was sensitive information in that. So that is an example of accidental loss. Now, agreed, the impact wasn't big because the moment they realized it, they reported it, and actions were taken to make sure that the information gets secured. But look at the situation. You had about 25,000 employees in your organization, and all of their name, social security number, and other sensitive information was shared with somebody who's not a part of your organization. It is a breach by the definition, and you need to follow the breach protocol that you would usually do in case, if it were a case of a data theft. So 34% of incidents are accidental losses, and they can be very easily avoided by training people, by letting them know what are the possibilities and how to take measures against that. If you look at industries, right, the number of breaches, of course, healthcare is right up there, simply because the data that you can get from a healthcare institute or anybody who's operating in the healthcare space has far more value. I mean, after the Equifax breach, pretty much everybody's name, social security number, date of birth is available for sale in the dark web, right? I mean, we're talking about 250 million adult Americans. So there would be a very small percentage of us sitting in the room here whose social security number is not available for sale. So, but when it comes to healthcare data, it has so much more, because not only can you use that data to, you know, get and steal somebody's identity, but you can use that for extortion. If I'm a hacker and I get access to your health records, which contains information which you would not want to go public, then there is value attached to it. And I can ask you for $100, $200, $500 to keep it secret. And that is the reason why they are the biggest target. So whether it is your health data or your customer's health data or anybody's health data that you are a custodian of, remember, that is one of the biggest things that hackers are going up for. The other thing to note here is there's not a single industry that is untouched. Because if you are connected to the internet, it doesn't matter which industry you belong to. You will have employees, you will have customers, you will have sensitive data. And that's what, as a hacker, I'll be interested in. So that is what I'm for. And that is the reason why you would see that, be it a not-for-profit organization, technology sector, government sector, doesn't matter. Everybody is impacted by this today and needs to take basic measures to protect their data. If you look at geography, the biggest target is the North Americas. So if you are an institute, if you are a company based out of North America, you are the target of about 60% of the attacks globally. And the reason is simple, right? Because it's a developed nation, you have more data available in electronic format, and the hackers can ask for a bigger amount of extortion amount if they get access to that data. So there is far more value to get data from North America than from, say, China or from any other country in the world. But it's North America, Europe, and then some of the developed nations in the Asia Pacific, which have the biggest, which are subjected to the maximum number of attacks. So what this means is, if you're based out of US, which all of us are, that in itself increases your risk profile from a hacking point of view. So let's look at a few case studies, right? And this happened in earlier this year. People Inc., which is a not-for-profit based out of New York, had a situation where about sensitive data like social security number, medical and financial information, health insurance numbers of about 1,000 clients of theirs got breached because somebody got access to the mailbox of two employees in the organization, and there were files in that mailbox that contained that data. And needless to say that it's still something that is being investigated, and you never know if the scope of impact would increase in the few months to come. But this brings back to me an example, and I would like to share that with you, which happened to a client of mine, right? So show of hands, how many of us here use Office 365? Everybody, good. Show of hands, how many of you have multi-factor authentication for Office 365 or two-factor authentication for 365? All right, so a few of you. So here's what happened, and this was a CFO friend of mine. He works for a manufacturing company in New Jersey, right? Somewhere around Thanksgiving, he got phished. Now, do we understand what phishing is? I would assume, right? An email which you feel is coming from your IT team but comes from somewhere else with a link or an attachment that you're not supposed to open. So he got phished around the Thanksgiving holiday. By the way, that's the perfect time to, if I'm a hacker, the day of the week that I would want to go after you is Fridays, because you are waiting for the weekend, you're not as attentive, not on Mondays but Fridays, or during holiday season, because you're not at your, you're not giving that much attention, you're more distracted. So around Thanksgiving, he got an email, he got phished, he did not realize it, where the hacker, and they were from Nigeria, we were able to trace that based on the forensic work we did, was able to get his password for his mail account. Now, Microsoft, and even in the old version of Microsoft Outlook, right, there was an option where you can check your email over a web. It used to be called Outlook on the web, and in Office 365, because it is cloud-based, you can anyways check your email over the web. Now, the funny thing is, employees don't need it, employees don't use it, but it is a feature that comes built in, and the IT team keeps it on. Like, if I ask you how many of you use the web-based interface to check your email, not even 10%. And it's not unusual. I have not used it in the last 20 years. I check my email on my phone or on my laptop when I open Outlook, and that's how you would check your email. But Microsoft has this feature where you can go to a website and log in your username and password, and you get access to your mailbox. So the hacker got access to the username and password for the CFO. He went to the website for their company's mail, logged in as the CFO. He set up a rule in the mailbox for auto-forwarding. Do we understand what auto-forwarding is? So you can set up a rule in your mailbox and say, all incoming emails, please send a copy to XYZ mail account. So he created a Gmail account for himself and set up an auto-forwarding rule where a copy of every email that was coming to the CFO was going to his Gmail account, the hacker's Gmail account. And then he logged out, and he did not do anything for 6 months. So what do you think is happening in the organization? As far as the CFO is concerned, he has no clue, right? That even he got phished, that he gave his password, and that he is leaking all his emails for months to come. And there are no red flags in the organization, because if you don't set up rules to raise flags on things like these, you wouldn't even come to know. So, now imagine the stuff that would move through a CFO's mailbox. It has to be, you know, payroll data, it has to be anything that is critical to an organization would always go through his mailbox. And this guy sitting outside in Nigeria was getting it delivered to his Gmail and was getting access to all of that data. Now the way they got caught was, 6 months later when this company was acquiring another company, there was a $6 million wire transfer that had to happen. And that's what the hacker was trying to do, right? Besides getting the data, he was trying to wait for that right opportunity where he can make a move and maybe change the message so that he can actually get money out of the company. So when that wire transfer was going to happen, he saw that message, and then he inserted or changed the number and gave a new number for wire transfer to the person who was the recipient of that email. Thankfully, that person, when he checked the number and realized, why are we wiring money to an account which is outside the country, picked up the phone, asked the CFO, why did you ask me to change the wiring information? And the CFO said, no, it wasn't me. And they went and did the investigation. They called us in, and we did the forensics analysis, and within a day, we were able to figure out, okay, so this is something that has happened. Thankfully, you have not lost $6 million, which you would have very easily. But now you are in a situation where you have 6 months worth of your data that was leaking through the organization, and you would need to analyze the impact of that breach and then take steps. So just the purpose of this whole story was to say that the technology that we use on a day-to-day basis has a lot of these loopholes or weaknesses that we as a user are not aware of, and we should not be aware of. But if it is not configured properly, and if you have not set the right types of flags to raise alert, then things like these can very easily happen. And from a hacker's point of view, if I try it in your organization, like we saw 15% of the people raise their hand and say, we have multi-factor authentication, which means other than the password, you would also get a PIN on your mobile phone to log in. If I'm a hacker, I try there, I fail, I'm not going to waste time. I'll move on, because there are 80% other organizations which don't have that in place. So from an organization's point of view, the best strategy to adopt is to be a little, make it a little more difficult for somebody to try and steal data from your organization so that you can divert them to other organizations, because you will always have people whose security would be not up to the mark. Another example, AMCA, and this is a company which facilitates medical debt collection. I think 3 months back, they disclosed that 20 million US citizens were impacted when data associated with their payment information and some sensitive data, including date of birth, was stolen. They provide services. They are a third-party service provider to Quest, LabCorp, CareCentric, all the big labs. Needless to say, right, it took them 2 months. They filed for bankruptcy, because there is no way when you lose that much amount of data, the costs associated with the response is so huge that it's a going concern issue. You would, unless you're a target who's, you know, a billion-dollar company and doesn't mind spending $700 million to come out of a breach, this is usually how things end up for an organization that gets hacked. City of Baltimore, again, a similar situation. Ransomware attacks, very common, right? And very easy to perpetrate, because as a hacker, once I code and have a code that would run, all I'm trying to do is cast a very wide net. If you have 500 employees, all I need is one person to be not intelligent enough to open that email or open an attachment or make it interesting enough for you to open the attachment. And once I can get into one computer, I can move around in your network and infect many computers. That is exactly what happened. It ended up with the not only were they losing revenue because they went, they stopped business for 2 weeks, the cost of coming out of that was close to $18 million. By the way, the hackers were asking for $76,000 in ransomware. That doesn't mean that if you pay the ransom, you'll get the data. But irrespective of that, the overall cost to the city was close to $18 million. So while we are at costs, let's look at some numbers that are available based on a study done by the Poneman Institute, right? On an average, you can expect an organization to spend about $158 per data record that gets stolen. So if you lose 1,000, multiply by the 1,000. If you lose 10,000 data records, multiply it by 10,000. That is your thumb rule to estimate what is the cost of keeping that data record secure. In fact, you can reverse it and use this for ROI calculation. Look at what kind of sensitive data do you have, and it is going to cost you X dollars if that data was to be lost. So are you ready to spend 10% of that today to make it more secure, right? So if you're a CEO, CFO, this is the data that can provide you that much information to come up with some sort of a return on investment calculations for your security investments. So let's look at some examples and you know what are things that you can do to just prevent and avoid ending up to be in this situation. So passwords, right? We all rely on password even in today's day and age. There are a few applications, few platforms that allow you to move to multi-factor authentication, which is great. But needless to say, 80 to 90% of our access to applications is still based on passwords. So let's take a quick look at a video clip, and then we'll go into what we can do in order to improve the strengths of our password.
We're just working on this, but the truth of the matter is, we need to do a better job of protecting ourselves. You know, the most popular password in the United States is password 123. And as long as that's the case, we're vulnerable. So today we sent a camera out on Hollywood Boulevard to help people by asking them to tell us their password. And this is how that went.
We're talking about cybersecurity today and how safe people's passwords are. What is one of your online passwords currently?
It is my dog's name and the year I graduated from high school.
Oh, what kind of dog do you have?
I have a Chihuahua Papillon.
And what's its name?
Jameson.
Jameson. And where'd you go to school?
I went to school back in Greensburg, Pennsylvania.
What school?
Hempfield Area Senior High School.
Oh, when did you graduate?
In 2009.
Oh, great.
It's like my cat's name and then just like a random number.
Okay. But, have you had this cat for a while?
Yeah, she's my childhood pet.
Aw. And what's her name?
Her name is Jolie.
Jolie. Mm-hmm. So like a password of yours would be Jolie and then a number.
Yeah.
Like number one?
Like my birthday.
Oh, when is your birthday?
June 12th.
Oh, nice. And what year were you born?
95.
Oh, great. Mm-hmm. So Jolie, 6, 12, 95.
Gemma.
Yes. Got it.
1, 2, 3. Spell G-E-M-M-A.
Well, most of them are Italian.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah,
Like, what's a good Italian password?
My grandma's name.
What's your grandma's name?
Maria.
Maria. So Maria is your password?
Oh, yeah, now you know my password. Oh, yeah.
One thing to notice there, and is how easily, within a few questions, right, she was able to get the password information. And there's a name for that. It's called social engineering, right? And there are people, and we have people on our staff, so we have hackers and social engineers on our staff because if organizations want to see how strong they are, we would run an assessment, like a fake attack on the organization, be it based on social engineering, be it based on an actual network attack. So, and over a phone call, you can get so much information from people that would help you, figure out what their password is or figure out other information about people in the organization. So that's what was very interesting as to how easy it is for somebody to extract that piece of information to guess the password. So here, we all use passwords. Here is a technique that we have come up with, which is very easy. Because when you're creating a password, there are a few key requirements, right? It has to be a long password. It has to be a complex password. It has to be easy to remember. And then you will need to change it every 60 days, right? Go figure. More importantly, it has to be different for each account. Do you know why? Because Yahoo got hacked and 3.5 billion Yahoo passwords are now available on the internet. So if I want to get into your account, as a hacker, the first thing that I'm going to do is go check that database, search your name in Yahoo, and now I know the password you used in Yahoo. And if you're using the same account, password somewhere, then that is going to be my first attempt. And then I will start some variations of those in order to get access to your account. Now, we know there are 14 billion data records that were breached over the last 6 years. So there is a database of 14 billion accounts and passwords sitting somewhere. And that is what I'm not going to go start guessing, is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? No. That is my database. I'll search that database for your name. I'll get at least 6 hits of your possible passwords that you would have used historically. and now I'm going to use that to get access to your account. So it's very important that you keep a different password for each account so that if one of those accounts gets hacked, which is beyond your control, by the way, then nobody can misuse that and get access to your other accounts, right? So here's a technique. Pick up a favorite song of yours, right? This is mine. Pick the first letter of each word, right? That gives me 9 characters, and that gives me a word that I can't even pronounce. But is it easy to remember? Yes, it is, because it is my song, right? All I need to do is sing the song and type the first letter of each word. Now let's add a number and a special character in the end. So now I'm at 11 characters. I'm meeting all the password complexity requirements that the IT team has set up. And I have what I can call as my base password. This is still not my final password, because remember, I want a different password for each of my accounts. So this is my base password. And then I'm going to prefix this with 2 letters in capital, which would be associated with the account I want this password to be used for. So Gmail, let me add GM in the beginning. Bank of America, BA, Chase, CH. So now, based on this rule that I've come up with, I can technically have a different password for all my accounts. I know how I arrive at that password, so it's easy to remember. And it is a 13-character password, which is, in all probability, pretty complex. In fact, there is a website, howsecureismypassword.net, where you can just key in your password and it would tell you how many years would it take for somebody using the current computing power to break that password. And we keyed that password in. It would take 3 million years, right, for somebody to crack that password, which is good enough, because the IT team would make me change that in 60 days anyways. By the way, if I'm a hacker, that's exactly what I would do. Create a website called howsecureismypassword.net, right? And invite people to come and check the strength of their passwords. Because what I'm getting your IP address, where you are coming from. Very easy for me to guess who you are. And then usernames are usually your email addresses, a variation of that. And now you give me your password. Neat trick, huh? All right, the second thing that a lot of your accounts would require you to do is have those secret questions, right? Don't answer them correctly. Nobody's checking if your mother's actual maiden name is what you're saying or not. Because if you answer them correctly, it would take me 10 minutes to figure the answer of that question, right? In today's age of Facebook, Instagram, and all the other social networks that are out there, LinkedIn, I can check out which high school you went to, which year you graduated, what your mother's last name was, what the name of your pet is, in not more than 10 minutes. So the only way to use that and make your account a little more secure is if you do not answer that correctly. So make something up and then use that as an answer. Just remember what you made up, right? Because otherwise you won't get access to your account. But, you know, make up a fake mother's name and use that across. And that is your alter ego or the other personality, right? So use that to your benefit, because that is the other way as a hacker that I can get access to your account. I would try going through the process of forgot your password, ask me a few questions. If I can answer that, I get access to your account, right? All right. The most common threats in the last 10 years, and this hasn't changed much, has been phishing and spear phishing, right? It means the same thing. Phishing is where I would send an email which is very, very generic. Spear phishing is, you are the CFO of an organization, I want to target you. So I'll do a little bit more research, figure out who the network is, who are the people you deal with on a day-to-day basis from your LinkedIn profile, and then send an email which would appear to be coming from either a vendor of yours, a colleague of yours, somebody that reports to you, that you are expecting an email from on a day-to-day basis, and then use that to attack you. That is known as spear phishing. Ransomware attacks are again very common, right? It's a modern version of a virus where it can lock your data and then ask for a ransom for you to unlock the data. And then the business email fraud, which is using one of these techniques to make you transfer money out to an account which you don't want to send money to, is again a very common threat. So phishing, any suggestions? What can you do to try and protect your organization against phishing attacks? Well, the first thing you need to do is identify your weakest links. In this case, it is going to be people, right? Because phishing is targeted on the human element of the space and not the technology. So there are organizations, and I'm in the space of security, and being with a CPA firm, I do a lot of audits. And this is one of our first recommendations for an organization, that every year, you need to test your own employees and figure out who is most susceptible to fall for a phishing email, with the sole purpose of training them. So you run a phishing campaign against your employees, and it would usually show you that 15 to 20% of your employees are falling for an email. Great. Now you take them through an annual training. And at the same time, you can have a positive reinforcement element there, where do a raffle for people who did not fall for it, or publicly acknowledge somebody who did not fall for it and give him a gift card, because that is going to inculcate a culture of people knowing that such a thing is happening, so they have to be more careful. More importantly, they need to bring it to the attention so that as an organization, you can benefit. If somebody gets a phishing email, chances are that others in the organization get it too. So they should just flag it, raise it to IT, and then IT should go and do a mass search across all accounts and make sure that those emails have been deleted. And it has to become a part of the culture, because attackers are getting more and more intelligent day by day. Then, so you first identify what your weakest links are, get somebody to do a phishing assessment, then you train them. A simple 20 minutes, 30 minutes training, show them things that can happen, what they should be aware of, and what they should avoid. And it should be done on an annual basis, just to make them think about security every time they are working on a computer. Always think before you click, because a phishing email, just by virtue of you getting an email in your mailbox, doesn't happen, nothing happens. You need to open the attachment, or you need to click on a link for it to trigger something. So think before you click. Use two-factor authentication. The example I gave, if the CFO and their organization was using a multi-factor authentication, even though the hacker got access to the password, he would not be able to get access to his mailbox, because when he would go to log into the mailbox, it would ask him for a second factor, which he would not have, you know, which can be over a cell phone or something else. So anything that is web-based in today's day and age should have two-factor authentication enabled, or there should be some form of two-factor authentication that should be utilized for that purpose. These are some of the top subjects, themes that you would see as far as phishing emails are concerned, right? You would see bills, email delivery failure, scanned documents, like everybody has scanners these days. So we are so used to receiving emails which would be from the scanner or from your voicemail box if you're using a VoIP telephone system, that as an organization, you need to figure out how do you manage that. Another very interesting thing which can be very easily implemented is you flag emails that are coming from outside the organization. Now, a lot of companies do that. Our company does that, where what happens is anytime an email comes, on the top, just below the subject line, I will see a tag which would say, this email originated from outside the organization. What that does is it makes me think, If somebody is trying to impersonate my CEO or my CFO and sending me an email, it should not be saying it came from outside the organization, because he's sitting in the room right next to mine, correct? If I'm scanning a document and I get an email and it says coming from outside the organization, that doesn't mean it's not right, because it's coming from within the organization. So such small steps, flagging things, giving, equipping your employees to look for things like these and then train them not to open attachments from an email, which should be from your colleague, but comes with a flag saying coming from outside, are things that would help you improve your security. As far as ransomware is concerned, what are the things that you can do? Well, make sure you have a daily backup. Backup of your data. If you get hit by ransomware and you have a good backup, well, the easiest thing to do is wipe that machine clean, right? Which means you format the whole disk and restore your data, and you've not lost anything. I mean, you would still want to investigate to make sure that you identify all possible impacted machines and data, but it's very easy to handle a ransomware if you have a good data backup to go to. Make sure you have an offsite storage of the backup. Why do we need to make sure that there is some sort of offsite storage? Because the ransomware, the way they work, is it's going to infect one machine. It will start encrypting data. Then it will see which are the other connected machines, start encrypting all of that. It also looks for a connected data backup system, because they know that people can go to the backup, and then start encrypting the backup. So if you lose the machine and you lose the backup, then you are in the same situation, right? You have no choice but to pay ransom. But if you have some sort of an offsite storage, that would prevent that situation of your backup getting infected, and you can use that to come back from a ransomware attack. Make sure you're using a reputed antivirus, anti-malware software. And I know it's an old slide, I should take Kaspersky out of that list based on the news that we had last year, but any brand name antivirus software, sometimes using a combination, because not all antivirus softwares can capture everything. So we also recommend using a combination. And the way it works is, at your email gateway level, right, you would use Symantec. And then on each end user workstations, you use Trend Micro or you use McAfee. This way, anything that is coming through the email gets first scanned by one type of antivirus, which is using a different signature list. And then your endpoint where somebody is going to open the file is going to get scanned by another variety. So the chances of you catching an infection is far more higher before it can cause harm. And most important, educate your employees. Believe me, the best investment that you can do in security is not buying a piece of firewall or investing $20,000 in the state-of-the-art technology solution. It is providing training to your employees, because none of these attacks are possible till somebody clicks on a link. 80% of any hacks that you would think of start with somebody getting phished, because it is easy. And make sure that your desktops, servers are all up to date as far as patches are concerned. Because Microsoft, be it Linux, whatever the operating system is, on an ongoing basis, they keep realizing, oh, I have a hole here, I need to patch it. I have a hole here, I need to patch it. And hackers are looking for those holes in order to attack your system. So if Microsoft has figured out that there is a hole and released a patch, hackers know and they can exploit it, but you have not patched it, then you are basically inviting an attack. So it is very important that you patch your workstations and you patch your servers very, very diligently, because if you do that, then chances are half the attacks would not work. There's another a quick recommendation. Anytime you receive a phishing email which you're not very sure of, because you know they are very well crafted, whether it is actually a genuine email or not, and you have that urge that I should open it on your phone instead of your laptop. You know why? A lot of these malwares or ransomwares are designed to work on a Windows operating system. Your phone runs on iOS or Android. So chances are that even if it is an infected email, it will not do anything on your phone because it can't work. It is not designed to work on that platform. So, and I don't know how long will this last, because of course the hackers realize this, that everybody uses a phone. So if it's a malware designed for an iOS device, then it will work on your phone too. But between the two choices, Windows and iOS, I would rather open it on my cell phone instead of opening on my laptop if I'm not very sure of a particular email and the content in that email. So that kind of brings us to the end of our presentation. I want to wrap up. As far as cyber threats and cyber attacks are concerned, it's not a question of if, it's a question of when, because it's very easy. The surface area which a hacker can use to attack you is so huge that it is very easy for somebody to try and steal data from your organization. So because it is inevitable, you need to know who should you call in case of a situation like this. In fact, you want to make sure and plan for that in advance, where you have some sort of an incident response plan in place. And at the very least, have some number saved where you can just give a call and say, we had a situation, can you send somebody to come in and take a look at it? Because if you start looking for that contact after the incident, the clock starts ticking. It can be difficult. And it's easy for you to do some sort of a due diligence beforehand instead of doing it after the fact. I mean, I get calls on Friday evening all the time from prospects and from customers, simply because once you're in a situation, it's like, you know, it's an emergency. You need to speak to a doctor. You need to speak to a specialist to figure out, what do I do now to restrict the impact and to come out of it? Run scans. Run phishing assessments on your employees. Run penetration tests or vulnerability assessments on your network. And believe me, these are not expensive solutions. Like phishing assessments, a few thousand dollars. It's totally worth it. And then make sure that whoever you identified as the weakest link, train them. As far as network scans are concerned, again, a few thousand dollars. Once in a year, you need to, like your preventive physical that you do for your health, you need to make sure you're checking the health of your enterprise by doing phishing assessments, network assessments, and whatever comes out of that, make sure you fix it. Things will change and you would need to do it again next year because the environment keeps on changing, but that is the only way to make sure you are ahead of the curve and a little more secure so that the hacker gets disinterested in you as a target and moves to the next one. Make sure you're working with an expert. And it's very interesting that a lot of small, medium organizations have smaller IT teams. As an IT person, there is one way you would think. How would this system work? How can I make this infrastructure work? As a security expert, your thought process is totally different. How do I break it? The same person cannot wear those two hats. So don't expect your IT person to look at an infrastructure and think, how are the ways it can be broken and what should I do to try and prevent it? He's not tuned for that. And that is the reason why you would want to make sure that you're working with somebody from the security side to test what the IT person has set up. And then both of them would work together to make sure that things get fixed. But do not expect him to be a security expert, because it just doesn't work that way. Needless to say, make sure it's inevitable. So make sure you have some sort of a cyber insurance policy, because if that day comes, it would help you recoup some of the expenses that we talked about. And finally, make sure at a business strategy level that you consider security as a very, very key component of your annual planning, because if you don't invest now, you might end up paying far more later, and it can very easily convert into a going concern issue. So that was the end of my presentation. Any questions, if you guys have, we might have a few minutes to discuss that. Sure.
So when you're starting out testing, you know, you can have a
Okay. So the question is, if you're doing phishing assessments, chances are that the first time around, it would be a very high percentage. Is there like a baseline at an industry level? The baseline should be zero. The reason is, all it takes is one person in the organization to fail in case of a real attack scenario. So the purpose of phishing assessment is not to try. You can measure improvement by seeing how the percentage is moving over the years. But more importantly, the purpose of doing that is to figure out where do you want to spend your security training investment dollars. Which is your the group that needs to be trained the most and is most susceptible to fall for a phishing attack? And it might not just be training. It might be making additional investment in technology for that particular group. Because you know that come what may, they are like, I'll give you an example, right? If they are a part of accounting team, they receive a lot of vendor invoices. They are going to open mails that have vendor invoices. Even if they are trained with the bulk of work happening, they might have a tendency to open it. Well, then you would work with IT team and figure out what additional controls can be put in place so that even if they fall for an attack, the impact can be reduced. Or there are other technology solutions that can help you with that. So that should be the goal and not just the percentage. Yep.
Organization serves, and I test positive for Hep B, or whatever, C, mm-hmm. I don't even know sure what's the bad one. And then a year later, I test positive for tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. Is that one record because I'm one person, or is that two records because it's two different things?
So as far as the definition of a record is concerned, every doctor visit of yours would create a bunch of records. Because the doctor spoke to you, he made some notes, that is a record. Ran a blood test, the blood report came in, that is a second record. They took your weight, height, blood pressure. For all you know, that might be a different record. So as an individual, we are leaving so many breadcrumb trails that if you combine all of that together, just as an individual, you might have 100 to 1,000 records associated with you in the system for a particular doctor. So each one of that technically is a record, right? If as a hacker I get access to one, two, or multiple pieces of that, depending on what I get access to, I can misuse that information.
In your presentation, you put up there McAfee, Norton. Compare that against the Malwarebytes, Cylance, and things of that nature. Because it seems like that's off the shelf and versus a high-powered.
Right, so I think the slide is a little dated. I should update it, and I should have a few of those names on the list too, because the whole nature of antivirus, anti-malware industry has changed from a signature-based solution to more AI-based solution, behavior-based solution. How is a program behaving, and is it suspicious, and if it is, then it should flag it. So all of those names that you suggested, Cylance, Malwarebytes, are all good solutions to go for. That is definitely not an all-encompassing list. Just make sure that you have a well-known product. You know, there are, if you do a Google search and say top 20 antivirus products, I think any one of those is a good product to go with. All right, that's it. Thanks a lot for listening to the presentation. Here is my contact information. If you want to create a in case of emergency contact in your phone, I hope I never get a call from you, but if you are in a situation, free feel to call and we might be able to help. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anurag.